Good evening and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the December 13th, 2016 meeting of the Downers Grove Village Council. It is my privilege to call this meeting to order on this crisp December evening. Welcome to all for braving the elements and joining us here tonight. If you haven't already done so, there are copies of our agenda on either side of the room. You can pick one up and follow along with our proceedings tonight. There will be multiple opportunities for public comment, both with respect to items that are on tonight's agenda, as well as a segment under item 4, which is reserved for public comments of a general nature. That means that any members of the audience have any questions or comments of a general nature with respect to items not on tonight's agenda. During that segment, we would invite you to come up to the podium, tell us who you are, and we'll welcome hearing from you at that point in time. But first, it is our proud custom to begin our meetings by reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. So I'd like to ask everyone present to please rise and join us in reciting the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you for joining us. And with that, I would like to ask our fine village clerk, April Holden, to please call the roll.
Commissioner Wallace. Commissioner Earl.
Here.
Commissioner Waldeck.
Here.
Commissioner White.
Here.
Commissioner Jose.
Here.
Commissioner Barnett.
Here.
Mayor Tully.
Here. Thank you very much. That brings us to item 3, which pertains to minutes of past council meetings. We have one set of minutes to review and approve tonight. If there are no questions, comments, or changes to our minutes from December 6, 2016, I will entertain a motion to approve them.
Mayor Tully, I move that this council approve the minutes from December 6th as presented.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None are opposed. Awesome. Just like that brings us to item 4, which as earlier advertised pertains to questions and comments of a general nature with respect to items that are not on tonight's agenda. If there are any questions or comments of a general nature from members of the audience, please come down to the podium, introduce yourself, and we'd welcome hearing from you. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is John Schofield. I live at 1125 Jefferson Avenue. And I'm unclear at the moment as to when I should be standing up here to speak. I wanted to speak to item G on the consent agenda, and I do not know whether there's an opportunity to speak on that at the time that it comes up.
There will be a very specific opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you for asking. We'll see you shortly. Other questions or comments of a general nature? Good evening. Welcome.
Yeah. Hi. I'm Rich Colavaney, 6825 Camden Road, and I'm here representing Friends of the Edwards House. Just wanted to show this wonderful calendar that our group came out with. Many thanks to Melissa Nyson, who did the design work, and a one Shannon Tully, who's been working hard actually filling orders. I think you all recognize that name. And Delara Photography actually donated their wonderful work, and Maximum Printing, another Downers Grove firm. So I'm not going to divulge exactly how many we sold, but it was three times what we originally planned on. So it was a great success, and it includes the recently landmark homes. So congratulations.
Awesome.
To Downers Grove.
Just in time for holiday gift giving.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you very much for sharing that. Other questions or comments from members of the audience with respect to items of a general nature, those being items not appearing on tonight's agenda? Good evening. Welcome.
Hi. Welcome. My name is Tim Werner. I live at 6736 Osage Place in Downers Grove. I'm getting used to this at this point now. I had some comments of general nature regarding to the proposal for the building, the property here right at Washington. I'm concerned, and I'm really speaking on behalf of Downers Grove for Responsible Government, you know, an organization that was created to make sure that there's proper good stewardship on our tax dollars. So with the recent development that's currently been going on in the village, 347 newly approved units as of recent, you know, it's we're concerned about the urbanization of Downers Grove and some of the externalities that will occur when that happens. You know, and I'm for development. It's not, you know, it's something that is good for the community, and you know, there is a growth aspect to that, but you know, there's definitely a concern. I'm putting together some of my preliminary studies and just some of my, you know, work where I can gather some information. And based on some of the initial proposals of information that I've been receiving, I'm just having difficulty imagining that this, or coming to a conclusion that this will not be burdensome to the general population on a tax basis. So, you know, so instead of saying nah, 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 you know, or not rejecting, one thing I would like to propose is if I could sit down, share some of my information with staff, and get some of their information as well, some of their projections. You know, as far as I know, is there a concrete bid that's been submitted for the property?
Not yet.
Deadline isn't, yeah. So, you know, a bid that would have to take place, because it's really, you can back into this, and staff knows this. You know, there's a rate of return, and there's, you know, a debt burden that would be, you know, imparted, and there will be tax revenues that will have to be generated in return for that to pay off that debt. Based on the size of the property, I must be missing something. I really don't, my preliminary, and it's just like construction units on, you know, to take what would be required to generate TIF revenue, you know, sufficient to pay down the proposal. I just have trouble, picturing it. So I must be missing something. And also, there's other costs with this urbanization of the community here. There's additional burdens. I mean, I was on my way here, and I was coming down, I was heading towards Maple here, and it was all backed up from Washington to Maple. Right now, it's not even moving. I did turn down Maple, and then I came down Bowdoin because I know the area, so I was able to get here. But it's like landlocked there, and I'm, you know, I'm concerned about what, you know, when that goes exponential, you know, with the population density, there's going to be things that need to be considered. You know, you need to look at that. There are a lot of externalities. Last time I came here, I spoke about those. But, you know, we've approved, or the council has approved 347 units already. So wouldn't it make sense to let that come to fruition? You know, that it's just being dug right now. But, you know, I think maybe, you know, maybe I'm just missing something, but I you know, I don't want to come before you and sound like a naysayer and be negative, but I just don't see it. And maybe, you know, maybe if I can schedule some time with staff and become more educated, maybe it's just a lack of education that I have on the issue. You know, so I'm proposing that if staff would indulge me to maybe schedule some time for me to sit with them. And, you know, and I have a couple of other people that I'd like to bring, so I'd like to schedule a time. And I would feel better. I mean, I'm looking at it as just my civic duty as a citizen. You know, I mean, I would, you know, I would like to become a little more informed, maybe become enlightened. You know, because, you know, I was part of a group that, you know, made an effort to be good stewards of our tax dollars, and then we followed through with a solution to address, yes, I agree, to address the needs. It was more of a needs-based solution, not a wants-based. But we thought we had a pretty good plan to address the police station, and instead that just, you know, I don't know, it hit the wrong file, you know, and then all of a sudden this all came up. And you know, if bids come, and I, you know, I also just want to caution, is I'm not a councilperson. It's a citizen. I'm not taking any crusades on. But I look at, you know, the TIF consultant, for example. Wouldn't it be, I know there's a lot of knowledge that staff has, and staff can put a lot of this together and look at comparables in other areas, you know, and look at what, you know, we know what the tax rate is, we know what they'll get back. So, you know, there's a lot of, you know, I think staff could probably put together a proposal, you know, on what could potentially be bid out, you know, and then, let alone then maybe get a real bid, so we're dealing in reality. And then, only then, after you analyze that real bid, I would think you would then issue for a TIF consultant. But why would you, it just seems like we're putting the cart in front of the horse, or we're trying to drive on an expressway backwards, you know. You would then maybe, after you've done some real analysis and some real thinking on it, and, you know, and thought of the externalities. So just concerned about the urbanization. I wanted to speak my piece. You know, there could be things that I'm missing. I'm for the development of the community. I mean, I think there's, you know, some beautiful structures going up, and that's all good. But, you know, when I look at the boundaries of that land and everything that goes around it and, you know, encompasses it, and if I try to back end a number of units that would sustain what you're planning on spending and what value those units would have to entail, it gets a little difficult. It gets, so maybe I'm probably missing something. But I'm just trying to do some simple math, nothing too crazy. So, but anyway, so I suggest, that's why I came up here, I suggest if I could get some time with staff, if I can arrange a meeting, you know, I would appreciate it.
Thank you, and I think that the level of curiosity and interest that you're expressing is shared by all of us up here, as is our civic duty, which is on par with yours. And I think on behalf of the entire community, the only thing you're missing is the same thing we're missing, is we don't have anything to analyze yet. So you're not missing anything, because we don't have any proposals to analyze or study. And I think it's a bit premature at this point to ask staff to sit down and talk about something we don't have before us yet. We should have something very soon. Very soon. And then I think it would make perfect sense for everyone to look at what it is that comes in, because I think there's some assumptions that may or may not be right, in terms of spending and units and all kinds of specifics. I think right now it's generalities, not externalities, that I think we need to have more precision on. And as soon as we have something that you look at, which by my understanding will be actual concrete bids, in other words, someone who's actually willing to write us a check to build right. something, it won't be from the in the mind's eye, it will be an actual market driven someone who actually wants to build the project and put their own reputation and dollars and whatnot in at stake, then I think we'll have something that we can all analyze, and I'm looking forward to doing that as diligently as you and the rest of the community are. So all I would ask is once again to beg for your patience, that once we actually have something specific that we're considering, then I think we can all give it as much and as in detail due diligence as it deserves. Okay. That's all I would want to say.
Did staff do a model workup? Did they look at the feasibility, the probability of this being a realistic proposal?
Well, and if you could actually please direct your comments to the council.
Oh, okay, sure.
I don't know what this is, and that's kind of what I'm trying to get at, is when you say this proposal, what is this? What we have asked for is for the marketplace, given the parameters we have, to come back and say, what would you, not what staff would think or what I would think or frankly what you would mm-hmm. think, but what would people would actually develop this property, what would they propose given the parameters that we have, including everything that you've outlined? And okay. what would they put forth, understanding that we have limitations on expense and units and density and land use, and we have all those requirements. The RFPs went out. We'll see what comes back. It could be something very different than what I'm assuming, it could be something very different than what you're assuming, or it could be something that perhaps is deserving of your concerns. I don't know yet. That's all I'm saying is, all I'm suggesting is, let's wait until we see what we have before us, and then let's study the heck out of it. I agree with you 100%, and it's either going to make sense for the community, or if it doesn't, then we move on.
Okay.
But at least we'll all know, and we won't spend the rest of our adult lives wondering, well, gee, what if we had just asked, what would, might we have received in return? We'll know.
Right, right. And then maybe I'm not thinking about this the right way, but once you get those bids, I think the TIF consultant doesn't immediately need to be employed. I mean, I think there's some time for different people to analyze this. Do you need to spend that money? I'm not sure that you need to spend that money right away.
Well, and yeah. Reasonable people can disagree.
Yeah, right.
Frankly, I've seen a lot of different developments come up in the last 20 years. And I can tell you personally, as someone who has to exercise that same civic duty that you talked about earlier, but on behalf of the entire community, you betcha I want to have an expert telling me exactly how to read those bids and whether the projections for numbers and revenue are solid. And that's not my area of expertise. I think we owe it to the community to have that expertise at our disposal. No different than other experts that we bring in when we analyze proposals to make sure that we're making the right decision. I mean, that's just good business. That's just good exercise of civic duty. And I think that's actually pretty typical of what we've done with other projects, whether it was Station Crossing, whether it was Georgian Courts, whether it was Acadia on the Green. We followed a very similar sequence of events of making sure that we have the expert on board, engaged, and ready to do that analysis that I think all of us deserve.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good.
And a lot of these things, if I'm correct, these are not to exceed contracts.
Correct.
Yeah,
work
so
is done in phases.
Right. So if we don't use them, let's say we get a bunch of proposals and none of us like it, we're not obligated to spend the money with the consultant.
Right. Fair enough.
But they're on board and they're ready to go, and we've got them locked in. More importantly, to the extent that they have a limited amount of capacity, we want to have that capacity reserved for us so that we can use it, not if there are other projects going on and suddenly we want to do that analysis, but now they're tied up in Elmhurst or a dozen other communities. It's just making sure we can get the information and the expertise we need when we need it.
Very good, very good.
But I appreciate, you know, thank you again for everything in the past and your passion, and look forward to sharing this information, and I hope we can roll up our sleeves and sit down at a table and really go over this and see whether it makes sense. Understanding that I'm pretty sure that we're not gonna make all 49,000 residents of Downers Grove happy, but you know what, we all work together and we act reasonably, I think we can get pretty darn close.
Right. Very good, very good. That's all I can expect. Okay, thank you.
Understood, thank you. Other questions or comments of a general nature? All right, terrific. Well, thank you for everyone that shared those with us. Greatly appreciated. Oh, I forgot to mention, I think the backup had something to do with the Metro because the gates were down for at least a good 20 minutes. I know our finance director had to drive all the way to Belmont just to get here.
Oh, wow.
So I think a lot of that backup was due to that. But you're right, we have three grade crossings in the middle of our downtown, more or less. Very good. Well, then we'll move on to item 5, the consent agenda, and item number G, 5G, resolution number 2016-7200, has been removed from the consent agenda. That will be addressed separately.
Mayor Tully, with respect to the consent agenda, excluding item G, I move that this council approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments, members of the audience, with everything other than item 5G as in Gus? Questions or comments from the members of the council? May I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The consent agenda sans 5G passes unanimously. Now do I have a motion to adopt a resolution authorizing a First Amendment to the Nelson Meadow Subdivision Improvement Agreement.
Mayor Tully, I move that this council consider a motion to adopt a First Amendment to the Nelson Meadow Subdivision Improvement Agreement.
Second.
And then Mayor Tully, I'd also move that we deem this a first reading for purposes of this evening.
Second.
I don't think you can do that, but we can always entertain a motion after we see what Mr. Popovich has to say, which I suspect he has something to say. What I would suggest instead is that we have a discussion. Now there's a motion, a second. You can always move to table to a date certain, but I don't think you can move to make it a first reading item. Mr. Popovich, you're standing there, welcome. How are you tonight? I get the sense you have something to say.
I do, I'm just dying to say something.
So I'm going to ask a question. No, I'm going to ask a question, so we follow proper procedure. I ask that Mr. Popovich tell us what he has to say.
Thank you, Mayor Tully.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mayor Tully, good evening, council members. With regard to the First Amendment for the Nelson Meadows subdivision, just to quickly recap, the subdivision's west of Main Street, a little bit north of 59th Street. Here's a close-up of the subdivision. Carpenter Street's on the east, on the right-hand side, Jefferson Avenue on the left-hand side, parallel to the bottom of the screen there. The proposal included a subdivision improvement in 2014 with the current developer, with a deadline for public improvements of November 18th of this year. It included stormwater improvements, sanitary improvements, water main improvements, street improvements, extension of Brookbank, Jefferson Avenue widening, and Nelson Court, and then site work associated with that development. What it didn't include in the deadline was the completion of sidewalks and final street lift. What we have in some of these residential subdivisions is, so we don't impact the public improvements, we wait until the majority of the lots are completed before the public sidewalks go in and final street lift. Sometimes sidewalks are in, then when contractors come out, they have to dig them back up and put them back in. So that was not included in the original 2014 subdivision improvement agreement. If we look at what's been completed to date, you'll see at the bottom here sort of an image of the subdivision. What we've completed to date is a lot of the heavy lifting, a lot of the big work. Sanitary sewers are in, water mains are in, water services to the properties on Jefferson, the existing properties on Jefferson are in. Water services are ready to go for the 10 lots that are going to be developed. Fire hydrants are in, the curb and gutter on Brookbank and on north side of Jefferson and Nelson Quarter in, and the first lift of street paving. So if you've been down there, Jefferson Avenue is now more of a full width street than it was and probably a couple months ago or so. What we're real close on as well is a couple of things, is storm sewer. There's just a couple of connections that have to happen there. And then finishing up some retaining walls on site. And then the basin, the detention basin in the southeast corner is pretty well done, but there's some fine grading that needs to happen in order to be prepared for planting in the spring. And then with our list of things that need to be completed, it's a little snowy right now to be planting anything outside, so that's got to be done in the spring. A final lift on the street paving, installation of street lights, driveway aprons for the existing properties on Jefferson there. Final grading, there's a couple of big mounds of soil out there that need to be restored and put back over where the grading plan shows them to go. And then parkway restoration as well on the south side of Jefferson, where the developer just recently completed the water service installations with the new water main. So that's sort of a summary. It's also in the manager's memo in terms of where we are, where the developer is with all the development. So if we look at the couple of different, the existing subdivision improvement and then the amendment that we're looking to have is include the sidewalks and the final street lift and to have everything completed by October 1st of next year. We really want to make sure that when the developer's finished, that the neighborhood has a completed street, a completed public improvements, and that there's nothing outstanding. So it's important that we get the sidewalks and the final street lift in there. What could happen, and potentially, is if we leave it as it is, the developer could most likely put in the sidewalks that are, in essence, along public sort of amenities, which would be Lot 8, where the stormwater detention pond is, and then along Jefferson Avenue. But then eventually, if the developer decides to sell off individual lots, we might have Lot 2 over here on Brookbank finished, put in a sidewalk light. Lot 3 might be sold, but the developer might not, the builder might not build right away. And then maybe lots 5 and 6 develop, and then lot 11 develops. So we have this piecemeal sidewalk. So what the village wants is for the final lift to be done on Brookbank, Jefferson, and Nelson, and then for all the sidewalks to be installed so that, and to have that done by October 1st is the deadline for that. We just don't want to have a half public improvements of sidewalks and pavement out there. We'd like for the developer to be in and out and be finished. We also are asking for this deadline. I don't really want to be worried in April about snow and the asphalt plants opening and if we're going to be able to get this stuff done earlier in the spring. So we're confident that it can be done, and we're confident that the October 1st deadline is an appropriate deadline. If there's any questions, I can answer for those. We can answer them as staff or the developers here as well.
Just a quick note on that. We did have a conversation with the representative from the developer, and they agree with the addition of the sidewalk system completion and the final lift of the street into the deadline as proposed.
All right. Thank you. As continuation of our discussion on this item, just to make sure I understand something, the sidewalks and the street lift are essentially being moved up. Do I understand that correctly?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. what, okay, so sort of some things are being moved up, and then there's an extension for other things to have up until October. Do we think that that is an appropriate timeframe, or is there an earlier one that could be? I mean, I understand that there's probably, given the cost of money, there's probably a internal motivation to move as quickly as possible on the non-public aspects of this. Maybe illuminate a little bit more why October as opposed to something else.
I think October is an appropriate timeframe. I think it will be done prior to that. I think we want to give the developer enough time so that if we have to go out and run out a punch list and get some final things done, that it's done complete and it's done correct before we come back with you to accept the public improvements. Okay.
And I, just to clarify too, in our conversations with the developer, and he actually submitted a letter to us several weeks ago, other than the completion of the sidewalk system, the final lift of the street, the other things that Mr. Popovich went through, I expect, and the developer expects, that they will be done in the May timeframe. So we were in a position, but for adding the sidewalks and the final lift, staff would have been recommending the same timeline as the developer. But after a conversation with the developer, the addition of these two items, we thought October 1st made some sense. We do expect all the other improvements to be in around the May timeframe.
And where are most of these other improvements? I mean, I'm sorry, the improvements other than the street and the sidewalks and the street lift, are those more affecting Jefferson Avenue, or are those more into the development itself, if my question makes any sense?
So there's street lights along Brookbank, so there's some little symbols up here.
Mm-hmm.
That are street lights. There's a storm sewer connection that's being made in this area, some water main connection here, and water main connection up in the northeast corner. So it's spread throughout. There's also improvements that some of the aprons, there's two aprons here that are going to be impacted by the development, need to be completed as well. So there's various things. In terms of the seeding, that'll have to happen in the spring.
Of course.
And then we've got a full season then to examine that and make sure that it's growing. So if there's things that aren't growing, first off, that we can have those replanted if necessary.
Okay, thank you. What would be the impact of not granting this extension?
Well, if we don't grant the extension, the agreement is still in place. All of the securities posted by the developer, letters of credit, et cetera, are still valid. And basically nothing happens until the village sends a notice of default. If we were to send a notice of default, it would just prompt what we have here right now, which is an updated plan and schedule for completion. So it makes sense to actually go ahead and extend it to make sure we're all on the same page. But if we didn't extend it, basically not a lot would change. The developer would continue to work and the village would continue to monitor.
Okay. Thank you. Questions from the council? Questions from members of the audience on this item? Good evening again.
My name is John Schofield. I live at 1125 Jefferson Avenue, as shown in that picture. Let me start at the end and tell you what I would recommend or request, and then tell you why. The change of the dates, we've known about the letter from the developer's attorney for a couple of weeks. It came to me via FOIA, and it didn't seem to require much attention. It seemed acceptable. The surprise on Friday afternoon when the agenda for this meeting was published was the extension of the time frame by a considerable amount, and that is why I'm here to speak to this. I would request that you do three things, and then I'll tell you why. First thing is to defer action on this item until, say, the January 10th meeting. That would lead to the second item, which would be to ask the developer for a punch list and a real timeline based upon what gets done between now and then. For example, I talked to the village stormwater engineer this afternoon, and she believes that sewer connection that Stan was talking about has been finished. So check that one off the list. But by January, you will have good facts on which to base a decision, which you do not now have. You have a list, but you don't have any timeline, you don't have any estimates of time, and that could be easily prepared in that timeframe. And by that time, the ground, I think, would freeze, and there'd be no work going on. There is work going on today. They were out in the snow yesterday and today trying to get that stormwater connection done. So the second thing is I would ask is that you task the staff meeting with the developer and developing a real fact-based punch list and timeline. And then third, at that opportunity, to make a decision on the appropriate dates for an extension based upon facts rather than speculation or wish lists or whatever.
I'm sorry, Mr. Schofield, can I just interrupt you for a second?
Sure.
Is what you're suggesting that if we wait a few weeks, we'll have more information and then we can have a different deadline, presumably
yes.
An earlier one?
It is my belief that the deadline that the village is asking for is way, way too long and potentially impacts the residents in a negative way. And I'll comment on that. But yes, the reason I'm standing here is that I thought the request from the developer's attorney was reasonable to get it all done by the middle of June. But to extend that till, was it the beginning or end of October in the draft? I thought it was the end of October in the legislation. It's just too long. And I'll tell you why. This started for us 12 years ago. It was 12 years ago this week that the previous developer, property owner, threw up an illegal silt fence, which, among other things, prevented families from having parking for holiday parties. And so we've been living with this for a long while. The development has been going on for now about 16 weeks. And I would say, first of all, and I want to say this very clearly, the developer has been very good. Communication has been very good. Consideration of the neighborhood has been very good. The excavating contractor who is on site every day has been extraordinarily considerate of the neighborhood. And in general, we've been, all of us who live on that block of Jefferson Avenue, have been well pleased with what's going on and with the minimalization of impact on our lives. So we're very happy with what's going on. And we believe if the developer is left to do his job, by the time the ground freezes, they will have about 3 weeks, maybe 5 weeks at the most, of work left to do. And you know, you decide when the ground is going to thaw again, but they can easily, very easily, make the schedule which they proposed. The reason this is concerning is because things happen. God forbid, bankruptcies happen. General economic collapse happens. Litigation happens. We've seen it. So right now, as Mr. Fieldman said, you have the ticket to go and take the letter of credit and get the work done should some catastrophe befall the project. Right? You can do that. If this ordinance is adopted as it's written, you would not be able to exercise that ticket until October or November of the next year. And that exposes us, the neighborhood neighbors who are most impacted, to a longer period of uncertainty, risk, and turmoil than we wish to endure, given what's already happened. So again, and let me comment on one other thing. It was our understanding all along that the completion clause in the completion paragraph in the subdivision improvement agreement said that all improvements would be done. That's the word all is there. And I did do a text comparison of the old language and the new language as presented in the ordinance. And they're the same, other than the date. So if there's some fix about sidewalks and so on, it ought to be looked at, because I don't see that anything is changing there. And that's okay, because we always understood that all meant all. And to have all done by June 15th is, I think, a good date to go for. So again, I just want to repeat. I would request that this no action be taken today, that action be deferred until the January meeting, that in the meantime, the staff and developer develop an actual fact-based punch list and timeline. It's a pretty short one by then. And then the council could make a reasonable decision based upon the facts, a reasonable decision that in my mind is as short as possible to protect the neighborhood as well as possible, and then let the business run its course. If there is no problem, the developer is in fact motivated to finish as soon as he possibly can, because he can't sell off lots until he gets your ticket punched, and we'll be very happy. It's the contingency of waiting till next October for these things to happen that has us concerned.
Sir, I appreciate that.
I have a threshold question. Are we limited to one date for everything, or can we have a list where various items have interim dates, where some things happen? So there's an exhibit attached that this will be done by this date, this will be this date, because I can see that some things might take till October, but not the ones that most directly impact Jefferson Avenue, so.
And Commissioner White, if I may say so, there, that is not an end date for the developer's liability. He has to post a, I don't know what the legal term is, two-year guarantee or bond beyond whatever date is agreed. So that if the grass doesn't grow, you don't have to, you know, you have his money for another 2 years to be sure the grass grows.
I'm saying, can we put a shorter date on some of the subset items and a longer date on other subset items?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sure we can. I appreciate what you're saying. Although what I'm hearing is there's really good progress here, and part of me wants to sort of get out of the way of this and let the progress continue, which would be the goal that everybody would want to achieve.
And Mayor, I say so. I'm happy with that. Just don't do anything tonight.
Well, no, we can't do that.
Sure you can.
I think that we tend to start to micromanage a little bit of situation. The other thing I'm concerned about is trying to tailor this so narrowly and pick that where this is going to have this month and that's going to be that month. I mean, as you say, a lot of things can happen, and they could. Most of them would not include bankruptcy or litigation or other things, which are always possible. But we're talking about 5 months here.
No, we're not. We're talking about
between
till
May and October is 5 months.
Well, but we're talking about a year since it was due.
I understand that, but what we're now talking about tonight going forward is the difference between May and mm-hmm. October.
And it's we're a trying big to difference for us.
I understand that, but we're also trying to tailor things, I think, a little too narrowly. And what we really want to see, as much as you, believe me, is that this get done right and it get done as quickly as possible. And I think there's a lot of people motivated to do that. I'm reluctant to try to tailor this so narrowly that we find ourselves back here in a few months doing it all over again.
So take the attorney's letter, take the last date on it, which is June 15th, and make that the date. It's his request. Why would you do more?
Well, because I think that there's what I understand it is the view is let's pick a date that is realistic from all perspectives, and then it'll be met, and we won't have to be back here in 4 or 5 months doing this again.
A realistic date, if things go well, is May 1st. I mean, if things go well.
Again, reasonable people can disagree. I'll open up some questions. Thank you, Mr. Schofield. Commissioner Jose.
I'd actually like to hear from the developer. In the letter that Mr. Schofield references, you do say completion of minor remaining subdivision items, by December. I really can't talk tonight. By June 15th, 2017. Why the additional request of October?
I think that was, by the way, good evening. I'm the guy you've been hearing about for so long.
Good evening. Well, actually, we've heard good things about you.
Well, thank you. And likewise.
Would you mind introducing yourself?
And I will tell you, I've really enjoyed, of all the other places I've worked, working with your staff. It's very productive.
Can I ask you to introduce yourself for the record?
Sure. My name is Patrick Franz. I am the owner and developer of Nelson Meadow.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So I believe that was staff's recommendation that we've had a few surprises over there. The records kept back in the day were thought to be good, but they're not as good as now. And there's been a number of public utilities that were not in locations that everybody thought that they were. So that caused some delays. And I think the fear was if that stuff were to occur again, while unlikely, that gave enough time to get the punch list done to the villages and my satisfaction. It is a long time period. Candidly, I won't need that unless John's fear of Armageddon comes, and then you know what? That won't be our problem. This will be a small problem anyway. So, and you know, the way agreements are written, I've got every incentive to get everything done there. So A, I can start building homes, and B, we can start reducing the letter of credit. As I, and I'm out there quite a bit, as staff will tell you, as I've gotten to know the neighborhood, I get the movement of people and residents, dog walkers, and all through there. And had winter not come hard and fast, I really had wanted to get the sidewalk in on Brookbank. The one item I will point out that I'm not sure Stan mentioned is also in our agreement in the spring, we have to mill off the original, currently existing half, south half of Jefferson, remove the curb, remove the driveway aprons, and then put them back. At the corner there, at the beginning of the curve in the Nelson Court, we're going to reconfigure some front yards a little bit. But the schedule that I gave you guys, unless we get an inordinately wet spring, we can do all that. We've got a lot of site work to do, but the good news is we're at a point now that simultaneous, unrelated things can go on at the same time. In construction projects, you have a point like when you're doing foundations, you can't be doing drywall kind of things. So we've passed that. We were very lucky with the warm fall. We got the streets, and I was actually praying that would happen. We got that, and so normally, winter kind of eases into things, but that didn't happen this year. We've got frost in the ground already.
Thank you. That was very helpful, and candidly, I don't know what the rest of my colleagues are thinking because no one's said anything yet. But rather than kick this to January and bring it up again and try to tailor it, I'd rather somebody make a motion to amend and just make it June 30th, based on what I heard. But I haven't heard anybody else say anything. Other questions or comments in the audience? There was a time when petitions were being circulated, guys, and I, you know, windows closed.
Was the letter June 30th or June 15th?
The letter says June 15th.
I was just going to give him another 2 weeks.
Yeah, I don't see a reason not to give him a little push.
Sure. I mean, that's just a suggestion. I could also call for the vote on the motion that's on the table, but I haven't heard anybody say anything.
Well, I'll move to amend the deadline date to June 15th. June 30th, we'll say June.
June 30th?
June 30th.
I'll second.
It's 4 months, and we don't have to talk about this again in January. All right, there's a motion and a second. So we need a roll. Any discussion on the motion to amend? All right, then a roll call, please, on the motion to amend, and then we'll have a roll call on the amended motion.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earle?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. All right, now I need a roll call, please, on the motion amended. So now this is the June 30th date. Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earle?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The amended motion passed unanimously. Now we don't have to address it back in January. Thank you for the input and the conversation. It's appreciated. And that brings us to the end of our consent agenda. And brings us to item 6, which is our active agenda. And we have a number of items on tonight's active agenda. First, do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance authorizing a special use for 1512 Ogden Avenue to permit a drive-through banking facility?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance authorizing a special use for 1512 Ogden Avenue to permit a drive-through banking facility as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the council? Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earle?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The matter passed unanimously. I'm going to pause and remind me if there was something on the active or the first reading that was coming off tonight.
First reading item, Mayor.
That's first reading. Okay. Just wanted to make sure I didn't blaze through this. That takes us to item 6B as in boy. Do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance amending certain parking and traffic regulations?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance amending certain parking and traffic regulations as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the council? Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That passes unanimously as well. It brings us to item 6C. As in Charlie, do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance rezoning certain property located at 3604 Douglas Road?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance rezoning certain property located at 3604 Douglas Road as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the council? Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That matter also passes unanimously and brings us to 6D. As in David, do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance adopting the 2016 aggregate tax levy?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt the 2016 aggregate tax levy ordinance as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the council? Commissioner Barnett?
Just procedurally, Mayor, can we, is there a procedural method that allows us to bundle all these?
The next one.
The next one, okay, thank you.
For the abatement.
Gotcha, thanks.
I'll let you make that motion. Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That matter passes unanimously. And now I'm going to ask for a motion from Commissioner Barnett with respect to items 6E as Edward.
Close to the special service area. It's not the abatement.
Oh, sorry.
We can't debate, we can't lump together the special service area.
Oh, I'm sorry. My mistake. I was getting ahead of myself.
Just give me a chance to warm up. Get ready.
I'll go with you. You just run down that path.
He wasn't arguing with me. All right, 6E is in Edward. Do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance levying taxes for fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 2, otherwise known as the Downers Grove Downtown Service Area?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance for levying of taxes for the fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 2, the Downers Grove Downtown Special Service Area as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the village council? Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That passes unanimously. I tried, Commissioner. That takes us to item 6F. Do I have a motion to adopt the levying of taxes for the fiscal year 2016 with respect to special service area number 4, the Green Acres subdivision?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance for the levying of taxes for the fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 4, that's the Green Acres subdivision, as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the council? May I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That passes unanimously. It brings us to item 6G as in Gus. Do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance levying taxes for fiscal year 2016 with respect to special service area number 5, the Atwood subdivision?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance for the levying of taxes for the fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 5, the Atwood subdivision, as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the village council? I just wanted to say that the benefit of this exercise is it actually reminds everyone what the special service areas are. Roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That passes unanimously. It brings us to item 6H as in Henry. Do I have a motion adopting an ordinance levying taxes for fiscal year 2016 with respect to special service area number 6, also known as the Fairview Fire Protection District?
Mayor Tully, I move that this council adopt an ordinance for the levying of taxes for fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 6, Fairview Fire Protection District, as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the village council? Seeing that there are none, roll call, please.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That matter passed unanimously and brings us to item 6 I, as in interest. Do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance levying taxes for fiscal year 2016 with respect to Special Service Area Number 7, the Dunham subdivision?
Bartoli, I move that this council adopt an ordinance for the levying of taxes for the fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 7, the Dunham subdivision, as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the Village Council? May I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That also passes unanimously and brings us to item 6J, as in jubilant. Do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance levying taxes for fiscal year 2016 for Special Service Area Number 8, the Nelson Meadows subdivision?
Bartoli, I move that this council adopt an ordinance for the levying of taxes for the fiscal year commencing on the first day of January 2016 and ending on the 31st day of December 2016 for Village of Downers Grove Special Service Area Number 8, the Nelson Meadows subdivision, as presented.
Second.
Thank you. Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from members of the Village Council? May I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That passes unanimously. Now, Commissioner Barnett, I'm going to ask you for a motion to adopt an ordinance for ordinances 2016-7093 through 7102, otherwise known as active agenda items K through T as in Tom.
Mayor Tully, I move to adopt ordinances 2016-7093 through 2016-7102, also known as active agenda items K through T, as presented.
Is there a second?
I'd be happy to second that.
Yes. Everybody wants to second the abatements.
Well, I didn't hear anything, so.
Questions or comments from the audience? Questions or comments from the Village Council? I'll just, as a reminder, the abatements is that beautiful procedure that we have here in Illinois where we have to levy the tax and then we don't collect it. That we've just spent a fair amount of time in item 6-something through J levying taxes, including special service areas, but because we have revenue from other sources, we don't anticipate needing to collect portions of those levies, so instead we are going to abate them, which means we will not collect them, and items K through T are those abatements. That's why everyone likes the abatements. May I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Earl?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The abatements pass unanimously. And that brings us to the end of our active agenda and to item 7, which is our first reading or our workshop agenda. This is the segment of the meeting where it's a little less formal. These are where items are presented for discussion and consideration purposes only. No formal action will be taken tonight. Traditionally, we ask staff to present these items for discussion, and we flip around the question where the Village Council will ask questions first, and then we'll ask for any input or questions or comments from the audience, and then we'll come back to the Village Council for any final questions. So with that, I will ask our Village Manager, David Fieldman, to please oversee the introduction of these items.
Thank you. I will, Mayor Tully. I will introduce our Community Development Director, Stan Popovich, to provide background on the first two items pertaining to 3300 Finley Road.
Hello again, Mr. Popovich.
Good evening again, Mayor and Council members. The first item is a planned unit development and a rezoning petition for the property at 3300 Finley Road, generally here in the northwest corner of the village, circled here on Finley Road between 355. The site here is outlined in red. It's the Fry's Electronics Store. They are applying for a planned unit development and rezoning to permit a revised sign package. Currently, Fry's has a variety of signs shown here. There's one monument sign shown on green, the green star along Finley there. Four large wall signs in red and the red stars, the locations for those. There's a close-up picture of one of the signs. That's generally what all the signs look like. And then the small blue star is a small electronics installation sign on the east facade. Petitioner currently has 1,887 square feet of signage. The petitioner is proposing to do is modify their sign package by eliminating the signs on the east and west facades and then installing a new code-compliant tollway monument sign along the west side there along the ramp to 355 North. The tollway monument sign measures 216 square feet, which is permitted by code. and the total amount of signage on the building and the monument sign would be 915 square feet. As such, they're requesting for a planned unit development to allow this signage, which is a reduction of over half the signage that's currently existing. With regard to the zoning ordinance, it's a, or the comprehensive plan, my apologies, is a regional commercial property. It's a blend of corporate offices, big box, and regional commercial uses. And then with regard to the zoning ordinance, the standards for planned unit development have been met, as well as the criteria for rezoning. Petitioner's here as well tonight. If you have any questions for him, or if there's any questions that I can answer, I'd be happy to do that for you at this time.
Thank you. Questions or comments from members of the Village Council? Commissioner White?
This brings back memories, because this was the last petition I heard as chair of the ZBA before being elected to council. And I was perturbed that evening that there wasn't a remedy, in my opinion, under the that would allow us to grant a variation, even though I strongly believe these signs are appropriate and necessary, and that they made a fabulous presentation to the ZBA about the economic benefits of having these signs. It's just that a zoning variation was not the right way to get to the result. I do support this, and I will offer the opinion that I think we need to relook at the sign ordinance for all properties that adjoin the tollways north of I-88, because the ability to basically create a large billboard that could have access to the thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of motorists that pass by is an economic development opportunity. But with respect to this particular item, I am in support of it.
Thank you, Commissioner. Other questions from the council?
I am also in support of it.
Thank you, Commissioner Earl. Commissioner Waldeck?
I do have a question, and I kind of put it in the list of questions, but currently they share a sign with Export Fitness on a different PUD, correct?
Correct.
Okay. What will happen to that sign? Could that go totally to Export, or will it still be Park Fries? Or
that sign is still a split between Fries and Export. The sign is located at the main entrance here on the north side, right as you come into Export. It's, you're more in line with Export there. That sign total doesn't count. It counts towards the Export area, but it was always intended to be a sign with Fries and Export.
Okay. That was an answer I was looking for. Or it's the answer. Okay. Yeah. But I do intend to support this. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Other questions or comments from the council? Very good. Thank you. Next item, please.
Item C is an ordinance amending stormwater utility fees. This ordinance would increase the monthly stormwater fees from the current $9.72 per unit to $10.53 per unit. This increase, which has been discussed by the council over the last several months, is consistent with the 2016 stormwater utility report, the FY17 budget that was just approved a few weeks ago, and the stormwater calculator that we used in the referendum question engagement initiative. This fee increase would generate the $3.9 million in revenue in 2017 for the stormwater fund. And of course, those funds are used exclusively for the stormwater system. If this sounds like we've been talking about this very number and this very rate for several months, we have. This has been in the conversation in the community since January of 2016. With that, we're happy to answer any questions the council may have.
Thank you. Questions or comments from the council? I'll just say that at the risk of repeating what you just said, this is what we budgeted for, this is what we planned on, this is what we've been communicating to the community. Quite frankly, would be consistent with their expectations over the last 6+ months. It seems to be fairly straightforward to do what we said we were going to do. Questions or comments from the audience? Very good. Thank you.
The next item, item D, amending citation provisions, we will actually not present that tonight. We will probably pick that up either next week or in January of 2017. Item E is a motion authorizing the purchase of replacement vehicles through cooperative purchase agreements. And here to present information on this item is our Public Works Director, Nan Newland.
Good evening, Ms. Newland.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This motion is requested to authorize the purchase of 17 replacement vehicles for the village. These are vehicles that were planned and shown in the budget for replacement in 2017. And by putting these contracts together early, we're able to take advantage of 2016 pricing, which saves us a considerable amount of money. Actually, these purchases are coming in $112,000 below what was included in the budget for them. That's a combination of the joint purchase agreements, purchasing in them 2016, and paying attention to our specifications to get exactly the right vehicle for the work, for what our needs are. As I said, there's 22 vehicles shown in the budget to be replaced. At this time, we're prepared to purchase 17 of them, and 12 of those are public works vehicles, one is for building services, and 5 are police pursuit vehicles. As Dave said, they're all being bought through cooperative purchase agreements, which are included in this item, and all items, all vehicles, besides being in the budget, they're reviewed and detailed by the village's fleet team, which is a cross-departmental team comprised of our village manager's office, finance, public works, police, and fire. We look at the life of the service life of the vehicle, but then we also look in detail at the use of it, the miles of it, and the history of repairs before we make the final decision to go ahead and replace that vehicle. So these vehicles were recommended by the fleet team, and the contracts are included here, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Terrific. Thank you. Well, first, thank you for coming in under budget. Good work. Other questions or comments from members of the council? Commissioner Waldeck.
Thank you. Not a question, but just a quick comment. Being up here for a number of years, I'm sure Mayor Tully remembers too, when these type of items came before us, there was a lot of debate and conversation, and we went over these, and things would drag out for a very long time. Looking at each and every vehicle, and over the years, we've managed to improve the process with long-range planning, with looking at our budget, and having the fleet team, and it seems to be much more organized, and a much more trusting process that we're looking at. And compliments on getting this done. Fortunately, we had to rush this in to get that quick pricing in, but very good. So I will support this. But I had a comment on the improvement of things over time. Thanks.
Thank you, Commissioner. Fair point, and well said, and I'm glad you did. And having that plan in place and knowing what we're doing allows us to take advantage of these windows of opportunity when they occur to take advantage of better pricing. So I agree wholeheartedly, and thank you. Other questions, Commissioner Barnett?
Good. It looks like there's a, this is not a matter relative to my opinion of the process, but is something with the Suburban Purchasing Cooperative, do they have a particular arrangement that it looks like we're moving all the Ford products more or less, in many cases replacing Chevy products, I don't care one way or another. I'm just curious, does that organization have sort of an intended direction, and does that then run parallel with what our fleet crew hopes would happen?
Not that I know of, but I can get you more information about how they look at the different vehicles.
Okay.
Some reason I could be completely wrong, which is 9 times out of 10, that there's been some shifts over time in who's manufacturing vehicles that are appropriate for certain uses. I could be off on that, but for some I thought that there may have been another shift going on, and that may have something to do with that. I'm not sure.
An example of that is the police pursuit vehicle that has moved from the Chevy Tahoe to the Ford because of the different types of vehicles that each company is making and which one fits our needs.
State police seem to have made a similar shift. Tahoes have disappeared, and they're all Explorers and Tauruses now.
Right. It used to be the Crown Vicks once upon a time, and then it went to the Tahoes, and it just kind of depends on what they're manufacturing that best suits our the needs for which they're required.
Yeah, my question really had nothing to do with those vehicles. It was the relationship between our fleet team and their thought process and that Suburban Purchasing Cooperative and how they arrive at their decision-making. That's, I'm just curious, not for tonight.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Earle?
Oh, I just wanted to say that the charts are really helpful, especially these ones that showed a life-to-date repair and maintenance costs. Some of that just makes your eyes want to fall out of your head when you realize how much we've spent just keeping some of this stuff going, and it's clearly time for it to be replaced then. Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions from the council? Any questions from the audience on this item? Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next item, item F, is an ordinance amending mobile food vehicle vendor provisions, also known as food truck regulations. This is a continuation of an informal discussion that was started by the council last week. Now we have an ordinance proposed. This ordinance would expand the permitted areas of operation to include office parks, as shown on a map in your materials. It would require background checks for employees with ownership interests only, as opposed to all employees. And it does not propose any changes to the current permit fees, although staff will continue to monitor, and if we need to make any changes or recommend any changes, we'll bring that back to the council. So we bring this forward with a recommendation to move ahead. Based on last week's discussion, we don't have any concerns or questions at this point, but we're happy to answer any questions that you may have on this item.
Thank you. And I just have a few since I didn't have the luxury of being here last week. Remind me, I know we had at least one expression, maybe two, of potential applicants who made some comment about the amount of the fee. The decision not, or the suggestion not to change that fee is driven by what again? We haven't been able to determine that that's actually a barrier.
Well, we heard from a couple of vendors that would like to operate here that they thought it was too much of an application fee compared to the areas of opportunity
I see.
To operate. And then based on the informal discussion last week, council comments and staff, we just don't have enough history with only one permit issued to see what our true cost to issue a permit is. This seems like the best estimate so far, and so the direction was to keep it there.
Understood. So the first step was to expand the area, see if that makes a better value proposition, and if it's still an issue of the cost, then we can revisit that later. Understood. Thank you. Questions from the council? Commissioner Barnett?
Just, Mayor, following up on your question last week, I think what I heard from a couple folks that spoke on it was the big issue was this operation area, but another one that played into it that's reflected in some of the changes tonight is the extensive background checking, the cost associated with that. You have an application fee, plus you have a per employee process fee to go through that. It was that combination with
right.
the area.
It adds up.
That adds up, not just the application fee. So it seems, at least from what I heard, that this reflects an attempt at getting at some of those barriers.
Understood. Thank you for the clarification. Commissioner Earle.
Yes, I wasn't all for just getting rid of the background checks on the employees. So I'm wondering if there is something else or some other way to basically get the same information, shared information, something else that's acceptable that gives us the same amount of assurance as a background check. Maybe if some other city has done a background check, is, you know, an affidavit from them good enough? Is, you know, one background check per employee by somebody in the western suburbs, is that sufficient for everybody? So I'm reluctant to abandon the background checks for all employees, but I'm wondering if there's not a way to get to the same thing without having to have as much of a cost burden.
Speaking, to sort of pick up on that a little bit, I'm entirely 100% in support of the proposed new areas. Also, to the extent these trucks are operating in commercial or office areas, the background checks doesn't concern me as much as it would if they were in the residential areas.
Right.
So as long as we keep these territories, there has been some thought that we would maybe someday deem ice cream vendors to be a variation of food truck and they're going down residential streets. That's a totally different question. From my point of view, when they're operating in these commercial areas, I don't know if I'm having the background check on the owner doesn't necessarily give me any more comfort than not having one, because these trucks are very expensive. So, but then that's the question, if we do someday look at allowing these types of vehicles or licensing these vehicles in our residential neighborhoods, then I will want background checks on the drivers, because the background checks on the owners doesn't really
right.
help us. If they're gonna be in Ellsworth Park, I'm okay actually not doing any background checks, because it's kind of, the guy that owns it isn't the guy I'm worried about. It's hiring somebody who, and then thirdly, finally, on the fee, set the fee wherever you want. The lower the better. We'll never recover our costs because measuring the costs will cost more than we could possibly get in fees. So that if you establish the village task force to ascertain the cost, it'd take us 10 years of fees to recover that cost. So I'd say set a competitive fee and don't worry about it. $100, I mean, I won't not vote for it at 250, but, you know, it's just, the idea that we're going to recover our costs, it's not, we can't do it because we can't measure that narrowly.
Commissioner Earl.
I had no problem with expanding the area of operations, but it was the fact that these food trucks were already allowed to go into and were going to be encouraged to go into the areas of the park district where these soccer tournaments or whatever would be going on. And, you know, we want to be able to help out in the tournaments in that way. If they can provide food, that's great. I just am worried about the number of children and the opportunities for something
nefarious
untoward to go on. So less worry, and even more so there even than the residential, because it's just so concentrated with kids. So while I'm concerned about the residential, I'm more concerned about the kids in the park. So that's why I'm not willing to give up the background checks for all the employees, but just wondering, I mean, you know, if that means having to lower the fee a little bit just to make sure everybody's got the background checks, I'm willing to go with that. But if there's another way to get those background checks, I'm all for that too, so.
It's also my understanding that they can't go on Park District property without the permission of the Park District. And the Park District could very well require those as a condition, or they, like the Park District or if somebody at the schools wanted to allow it. So, but we're getting kind of hypothetical here as long as we're, it's just my point is that doing the owners doesn't make a lot of sense to me for the commercial areas because we can save them even more money by not, by not doing that.
I wasn't thinking just the owners. I was thinking leaving it the way it is.
Thank you. Commissioner Jose.
Thank you, Mayor. Completely support expanding the operation areas for the trucks, but I happen to agree with Commissioner Earl when it comes to the Park District. I think getting rid of the background checks in all of the areas is a bridge too far for me. I brought up the idea last week of perhaps a second class of license. I'm fine with the background check, or even if you want to leave it on the owner, even if he's not an owner operator, with regard to places like Ellsworth or the commercial areas up near Butterfield. But when it comes to the Park District, I'd rather leave that in place. And if the fee changes as a result, or we accept a background check from another community, as long as it's got a reasonable time limit, I wouldn't want a background check that's a year and a half old or something. But I would let our police department tell us what's a reasonable amount on that. But yeah, we need to find a way to really get this ordinance moving, but I don't want to do it at the expense potentially of public safety.
Yeah, on that note, though, I understand that concern, but I'm persuaded by Commissioner White's point that the schools in the park districts don't have to allow it at all, and if they do, they can set their own terms. I'm not even sure right now if we require background checks for people who handle concessions at park district events, or we don't have any control over right now. I don't want to get too nanny state and start telling other governing bodies what they can and can't do. I would rather say, look, if you're going to, obviously, I think they were probably even more acutely aware of some of the issues that we may be in terms of what goes on in their property. And yet we don't require background checks for people who are running concession stands on park district property right now. And the same concern would be the case. That's why I'm not in favor of that.
Well, in that respect, they're also not driving any place with that. So you've got a mobile.
Yeah, right, the food truck is sitting there serving food. Ice cream trucks, great. Whole other category. We'll talk about that some other time.
Food truck is hot.
That's another issue.
We have time.
But the food truck that's selling $12 tacos in the park district, I don't think it's quite the same thing. And there are already vendors that are there interacting with children that we're not requiring background checks for. Never have.
To my knowledge, the park district's never approved any.
Well, right, which goes back to your point, which is they can say.
Right, but I don't want to abdicate our you know, responsibility and put it all on the park district and school district either. I hope that they would want those mirrors.
But that's their current responsibility is my point.
But that's not our responsibility.
It's their responsibility now, when it always has been.
Whatever goes on, the guy that decided to sell T-shirts at Socktoberfest, we don't have any idea, and we're not going to start trying to have any idea. He goes to the park district and either gets approval or authority to do so or not.
Well, the fact that we're talking about the ability to do it says that it is, at least in some measure, our responsibility.
By affirmatively licensing them, we're taking some of the responsibility from the schools and the park districts.
No.
No.
Absolutely not. What we're saying is that the park district...
You were right the first time.
Yeah, the park district can do it if they'd like to. We're actually not licensing them.
The park district or the schools, who are they going to call? They don't have their own police department or detectives.
No, it's...
They call on us.
No, that's, but whether to have and who to have on their property and under what circumstances is in the purview of those governing bodies. I mean, they're secure, we don't also regulate their security, who can have access to what school, what doors they go in. We don't do that either. Never have. We don't set the security protocols for who can visit a grade school. Who can be a visitor, what identification they need to show, whether they need to have a background check, whether they have to show ID to prove they're a parent. We don't do any of that.
Maybe like some of the ordinances that we defer to the judgment of the park district, and they should not rely on our ordinance.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Waldeck, you had your hand up.
Okay. Well, as far as the overall license fee, I agree we should keep it the same. If our experience shows that it does cost less, we can always reduce it later. As far as expanding the territories, I have no problem with that, except I was thinking, as the gentleman was commenting last week about not being able to get a truck over in the Ellsworth district for his business. I think if we expand it, I think there's a very likelihood that he still won't have a food truck, because there'll be food trucks will tend to go where there's the most business. So we still may wind up with a food truck shortage in that area, but you know,
won't be for lack of trying.
Let's expand it, and we're doing an invitation. This is an invitation process. As far as background checks, I really don't care. I mean, if we have background checks on the owners, you know, if they're ex-cons that are trying to straighten out their lives and starting out a business, that's fine if they're operating it from home. My concern is who's in the trucks and who's driving the trucks. It isn't just, it's for the protection of our residents, and I know we're worried about our kids, but then they're also driving on our streets, they're also parking. There was it was a school bus driver that they didn't have a background check on. They found out that after a deadly accident, that they probably should have had a better background check on his driving and his records. So $60 for a background check, as a business, businesses don't want to pay for licenses. They don't want to pay taxes. And, they want to be able to run things the way they want. We have a responsibility. And so to tell them that we're going to put the burden of getting background checks on the owners, well, if they aren't willing to give us $60 to do it, I'm certainly sure that they're not going to spend anywhere near that amount to do it on their own, and they'll just say, trust us. So as far as accepting background checks from other entities, whether it's another municipality or the state or county or whoever, if those are out there and they exist, well, then that's the important thing is not the $60, but the actual background check. And like I say, it's not just the kids and the people, they're also driving on our streets and parking, and they need to obey all the rules. And so a background check I think would be advantageous. I want to keep the background checks on anybody who's in serving the public and driving those trucks. And that's just my feelings on the topic, so.
We should then now be requiring background checks on everybody who applies for a municipal parking permit because they're driving on our street. I'm just kidding. I think we're going too far with the background checks. I think what's been proposed is a reasonable compromise. We're stretching into areas that we've never regulated, and
See, I don't really see it as a compromise, because we're imposing a burden with very little benefit.
I'd be happy to actually get moving on.
It seems to me we've already gone into that area that you think has gone too far, Mayor. It's already in the ordinance.
Which is why I'd be happy to take it out. I do remember this ordinance being passed as a compromise amongst a number of people who had various concerns and wanted to put it out there and see how it works. And I thought it was more important to get it going and spur some economic development in our community and support facilitation of business. So I was fine with it. But given the opportunity to remove it, I think it's an unnecessary burden. There are numerous businesses that operate right now, and you have no idea who these people are. You don't require background checks. They interact with the public and children daily. And we don't require that now. I think it's unduly burdensome on business. I'd be, given the opportunity, Commissioner, I'd be happy to take it out. But I'd be willing to, rather than hold things up, let's go forward with this compromise. But in my opinion, it's an unnecessary governmental regulation. Commissioner Barnett?
I agree with you, Mayor, to a point, I guess. I agree with you. I would go forward with this if that's what we could do to actually move forward. But I still have a problem with the background checks, because I think we're sitting up here thinking background checks, and I asked last week if there was a list, and there is. Didn't know about the list exactly. I didn't read it that close. But it's one thing to talk about kids, right? We want to be kids safe. So we've got stuff in here about sex offender registration acts. We've got people, who have had been convicted of intent to deliver controlled substances. There's some things on there that I suppose you could make some sort of a case for. I don't believe that's the case, because as you've described and Commissioner White has touched on, we've got so many other things. I mean, we have 50,000 people coming in this town every day, and we're not background checking all the plumbers driving trucks. But more specifically, even with this compromise, I still have a real problem with it, because it says any felony conviction in 10 years. And if our problem, if my colleagues who have this sense of obligation to protect our residents or our kids in particular, it sounds like, that's a fair feeling to have and a fair obligation to feel compelled to fulfill. But any felony obligation, any felony conviction in 10 years, that is a list longer than, 25 of these ordinances. And I'm not sure that we really mean that when we're saying, when I'm hearing the tone and the content and the context up here, rather, there's just a long list. And I don't know that we really mean to say to somebody, you can't drive a food truck in our town because you got busted ripping off $500 worth of stuff 9 years ago. Really? So that's what we mean? That person is somehow a great public risk? I'm not convinced. I'm not convinced we have to have any background checks. But even the compromise going forward, that first line to me is just the ultimate sort of catch-all, make us feel good because we said we're doing background checks kind of thing. I think it's ridiculous.
Well, I tend to agree also, just as a practical matter. And again, I'm not talking about ice cream trucks. There will be another time for that. That's a different situation. When you're talking about food trucks, you're talking about a major investment that somebody made in this vehicle. They didn't just go buy a white panel van, paint Good Humor on the side. I'm sorry, that was a trademark violation, I'm sure. They had to get a county health department permit for food preparation. They actually have to have the skills to do it, so this isn't just somebody who's handing out push-ups. And there's an insurance requirement. There's a whole bunch of barriers to entry here to begin with that I think go a long way towards addressing a lot of these issues. And to add a background check on it, I agree, I'd remove it altogether because I don't think it accomplishes what has been identified as the goal here. I think there are other things that do that as a normal course, and we're just imposing a regulation on one business that we don't impose upon an awful lot of other businesses that the same thing could be said for. Ice cream vendors, different story, because I think that's a different business that operates in a different way in many respects that we've identified. But again, to move this forward to where we're at, as we've kind of done this in an iterative process, where as our experience dictates changes, I'm fine with that. So let's move forward, try to see if we can facilitate more users to get the overall goal that we set out to achieve when this was first adopted. And if we need to make more changes as we go forward, we'll make more changes.
Well, what if we kept the background checks the way they were and made the fee $50?
To lower the overall financial impact, right?
I think that would achieve one goal, but I still think I don't think it accomplishes what everyone's suggesting it does. I think it's just an unnecessary obligation that we don't impose upon a whole similar situated people.
It's administrative burden.
I think the complaint was that there's such a turnover in employees that it becomes a major cost. So why not give the food truck vendor an option? And he can pay $60 for one, or $150, and his, you know, and we'll do the background checks on, you know, 10 people, or whatever.
The $60 refers to an outside cost of fingerprint processing. It would be an actual out-of-pocket cash event for the village.
And on top of that, take background checks, or allow, or mutual agreement on background checks from other entities.
Okay, clear direction.
Just a suggestion.
I just wanted to clarify, so Commissioner Waldeck, you're suggesting the fee be set at something else, and then, or whatever, and then include a certain number of background checks?
Sure, why not? If their complaint isn't the background check, but it's the cost, then, you know, maybe we can help out with the...
Well, I think it goes beyond just the cost issue. I think the background check is just something we're imposing upon one group that we're not imposing on similarly situated groups, from what I've heard. There are plenty of businesses in this town that attract kids, and we're not requiring background checks on any of those people. In fact, there are businesses whose primary function is to attract children, and we do not require background checks on them.
Yes, that's true, but those businesses will be in the same spot tomorrow.
Maybe. We could have litigation, we could have bankruptcy.
The point is that an ice cream store is not driving down the street.
I'm not talking about ice cream trucks.
Well, no, but a physical store isn't moving.
And the food trucks aren't, well, when the food truck is operating, it's not moving either.
If something happens...
When it's interacting with customers, it's not moving. That would be a little difficult, would be another violation.
If something happens and you have to make a report and say, this is where it happens, now it's all, it didn't happen at this store, in this store right here. It happened over here where there was a truck parked, and I think it was a taco truck, but it could have been a hot dog truck that was serving tacos that day, and it just gets a little dicier. That's all I'm saying.
Well, I think there's a reasonable minds can differ, and we're not deciding this tonight.
Good thing.
For my colleagues that are focused on retaining the background check, I'd ask them to consider what's written here. Because I think there's background checks and there's issues that might give our residents pause that it's fair to be concerned about and cautious about, but it's certainly not all felonies.
Yeah, and I'm not worried about financial felonies, for example.
I know, but the thing says all felonies, so you got it's 10 years, so you got a 27-year-old kid that did something stupid when he was 18 and got petty theft, or not petty theft, over $500, and all right. Of a sudden you can't serve tacos in Ellsworth? Come on, guys.
You raise a reasonable point, but that's not one that was raised before about 10 minutes ago. I'd be willing to think about that. But, I mean, the issue that was brought forth was the cost, not necessarily
the length
of the period or the scope of the exclusion.
I know. This was me interjecting this, having not been here last week. That's what this is. Anyway, to go back to this, obviously, I think a lot of these issues we're all in agreement on. I haven't heard any disagreement about the area, and the fee is staying the same. The area is being expanding. The only place of disagreement is on the background checks. And frankly, while I have concerns about having some of this at all, again, I'd be happy to go with the request to change so we can approach this again in sort of an iterative way. We're tweaking this as we go because we were trying to achieve the goal of facilitating the economic function within our community as a desirable activity. And so I'm fine leaving. When I say I'm fine leaving it until the next experience to see whether it needs to be further tweaked. And maybe we never come back to it. Maybe we do. But I'm not advocating we remove the background checks right now, although if I had my druthers and we were starting from scratch, I would.
Can always take more out.
Right, which is so where I'm kind of coming back is I'm fine with the requested changes for now. And then we'll see where our experience takes us down the road.
Just to be clear, that means reducing the background checks?
Well, yes, but not eliminating them, which I would make a case for that, but I won't. I'd rather facilitate the economic function.
I would suggest you're eliminating the ones that make the most sense. Yes, thank you.
And keeping the ones that are symbolic.
Yes, that's exactly.
So we want to keep, we want to go back to the original.
Eliminate both.
On the operator, not the owner, operator, or applicant, but the operator and servers on the food trucks. The people who are on the food trucks, not the owners. Correct?
Correct.
No, the I understood the reason why it was the owner, limiting the owner is less of a cost, because you don't have to worry about the turnover issue. If you flip it to the employees and not the owner.
But we're not worried about the owner.
Right.
Unless he's the guy driving the truck.
Well, in many cases, it is. That's the chef. That's the person who invested in the food truck in the first place.
Well,
then it doesn't make a difference.
We're not worried about him.
Now, Commissioner Waldeck rightly characterized one of the big concerns, which was this turnover issue. And there's an administrative burden that's not only on the owners, but also on us. If we're going to say that we want background checks on every employee, then we're going to have to manage the process of somehow, I don't know, check it in or something. There's two sides to that burden. It's not just the owner's cost. There's us. I don't want to screw with trying to track that all down for what I think is almost no gain.
Right.
We do know there's area of create agreement on the operating areas, so right. We'll probably proceed with that in the next round and keep the discussion about background checks moving ahead in an iterative process.
Makes sense.
I just want to make one quick comment about the economic development side of this. I think this is a very important, necessarily with the symbolism or image. I think it's very important that the village appear that we do attempt to accommodate these types of businesses. In terms of actual impact on the economic state of the village, I think the numbers are vanishingly small. And I hesitate to say this, because I don't care all that much, I'd be surprised if they all filed their sales tax. So as a consequence, I'm not advocating we go and ask if they do, because the cost of doing that would exceed the sales tax that we earn. But the idea that this is some economic boon is ridiculous. This is about public relations and only about public relations. There's very little economic benefit. I'm all for the public relations. But that's what we're talking about, because if a $250 application fee is a barrier to entry, they're not making very much money. And I want to reduce that barrier to entry because I think they're cool. I think they add to the image of the village. I think they're a positive thing. But there's no meaningful economic development here.
I beg to differ in this respect, and that is you're looking at it too narrowly. If you're looking at the sales tax generated from $12 tacos, you're absolutely right. But if you're looking at a entrepreneur that is testing a food concept in a neighborhood that may draw a following and then decides to open up a brick and mortar restaurant, once their concept has been proven, which is, by the way, the exact economic development model that's used in Cincinnati and in Portland and Seattle and countless other cities across the United States, then I disagree with you. And I'm not suggesting we have any evidence to do that because, frankly, we haven't had any real activity yet. It also can be an ancillary benefit to businesses in office parks. So if you look at it from the $12 taco, yeah, you're absolutely right. But I think we can't look that narrowly. I think we need to be more, less myopic about what the potential impacts are. And I just know that in other cities, and yes, they're larger than Downers Grove, there are years of studies that indicate that there actually is a fairly positive economic impact. Commissioner Barnett?
You used the term earlier, Mayor, nanny state, and that might have been hyperbole, maybe not. But I think that Bill, I think you're right, but I think it extends beyond. This is just one piece of creating an environment or an expectation. And are we, the village, looking for opportunities to regulate or looking for opportunities to facilitate? I think is kind of one of the questions that's in play here a little bit. Maybe that's a little too dramatic for two or three taco trucks, but it extends to other issues. Are we, I kind of raised that issue a couple weeks ago on another subject, and I think that the PR shouldn't be undersold either, because not necessarily the coolness of the taco truck, but the idea that the message we deliver to the entrepreneurial world is that we're looking for opportunities to take those new ventures and help find some way to make them fit within what we do, or not.
Absolutely.
That's the, I think that's the, one of the big benefits here.
Well, whatever the manager said a moment ago, I think that's where we're going. And just for the record, we spent, I think, 60 seconds talking about the tax levies and 25 minutes about.
We did have a few other public hearings.
Yeah.
Oh, you're right. You got me there.
A few hours.
You got me there. You got me there. You're right.
Days, weeks.
I retract that point. It was poorly made.
We do have one item left on our first reading agenda, which is item G, authorization to execute a contract with Kane McKenna and Associates regarding tax increment financing consulting services. Here to provide the background information on this item is our deputy village manager, Mike Baker.
Good evening, Mr. Baker.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. This item does request authorization of an agreement with Kane McKenna and Associates in an amount not to exceed $70,000. It will provide expertise necessary to allow for thorough review of development proposals related to redevelopment of a portion of the Civic Center site. Those proposals are due this Friday. And once they're submitted and fully analyzed, a comprehensive report will be brought back to the council for consideration, along with opportunities for community input as well, as was discussed a little earlier this evening. And if council then directs further consideration of this option that may include creation of a TIF district, this consultant and this contract would allow for the necessary expertise to make that happen as well. But of course, if none of these actions actually occurred, we would only incur the cost for the work that was performed. So, Kane McKenna was selected following a competitive request for proposal process, and the village has had experience working with this firm in the past and has been satisfied with their performance. Be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. Questions from the council? I just realized I don't think I ever asked for any questions on the food truck ordinance, did I? Do I dare appraise that again? Just for record, I give everybody a chance. All right, so back on this item, Commissioner Waldeck.
Let's see, so with the bids coming in on Friday, and then this on the first reading. So we're talking, you know, at our December 20th meeting, deciding whether or not to go with the TIF contract. Wouldn't it be better if we take a little more time to look at the actual bids as they came in, run some rough numbers or whatever, really take a look at them before we actually take a vote on obtaining a TIF contractor?
Staff will certainly be able to give you an early indication of what those proposals look like. And our timeline was established in a way where the expertise of the TIF consultant early on is going to be important to allow us to complete that analysis and bring it back to the council for consideration.
Well, speaking for myself, I'm more than comfortable allowing staff the discretion of deciding whether the bids warrant presenting them to the TIF consultant. That in staff's internal evaluation of the initial bids, if none of them work, hopefully they won't be given them to the TIF consultant. And I don't think and our next meeting then is January 10th. I think that really stretches out the timeline further than we want it to go. So that they don't have to spend the $70,000. I don't think we need to debate or we don't need to evaluate the bids before we decide whether to hire the consultant. I think we can delegate that to, we can let staff make that decision, knowing that the ultimate decision will be ours after all the facts are developed.
Thank you, Commissioner. Other comments? Any questions or comments from the audience? Thank you.
That ends our first reading tonight. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you very much. That brings us to item eight, the mayor's report. And I have two things I want to share. One is, as I think everybody knows, in November before Thanksgiving, I was able to attend the annual city summit that is hosted by the National League of Cities, of which the village is a member. And it's always a very worthwhile exercise. There's a lot of sharing of ideas and education that's provided to city officials from across the country, all shapes, sizes, colors, creeds, locations, experiences. But it's always really amazing to me the common problems and challenges that we all face and how we can learn from one another. On the 20th, I was, with the indulgence of my colleagues, planning on giving you a mercifully brief summary of just some of the takeaways that I thought would be of interest to the council and to the community. It won't be very long, I promise, about 15 minutes, but I just want to give you a heads up. I would have done it tonight, but I want to make sure that Commissioner Wallace, despite her attempt to try to avoid my presentation, will be here for it. So when she's back, I will have that for everybody. I think it's the least he can do is share some of the interesting ideas and facts and takeaways from it. I think you'll find at least some of them interesting. And as some know who have been around for a while, we've adopted some ideas that have had their origins in the City Summit National League of Cities. So it's been worthwhile. That's item one. Item two, just want to remind everyone that we are having Coffee with the Council this month. It will be the holiday edition of Coffee with the Council on December 17th from 9 a.m. till 10 a.m. at the Downers Grove Public Library. I'm sure the signage will direct people where to go. And this is an opportunity for members of the public to informally meet with members of the council who are able to attend, as well as village staff, and talk about ice cream trucks or whatever you'd like to discuss. It's always a good event, and it's the last one of the year, so we look forward to it. And I lied, there is one more thing I wanted to mention. This is just more for my colleagues. Traditionally, we have, with the turnover of every council, with the seating of every council, we have conducted something that has gone by various names, but it could be called sometimes a governance retreat, where basically that council for a two-year period will sit down and basically confirm how we, what our expectations are of one another in dealing with ourselves and also how we conduct ourselves. Typically, we'll bring up things such as the liaison positions that the different commissioners will have, the different organizations, so on and so forth. We typically don't do that until at least a month or so after the election. We're in a very unique situation. I think someone confirmed that we haven't had an uncontested council election in 20 years. I don't see any reason to wait to have that meeting, and I've suggested that we do it in January because this is the council that will serve for the next 2 years, given the uncontested nature of the incumbents who, thankfully, thank you for rerunning. I'd like to propose that, but at that time, I also want to bring up the topic of liaison roles. I think we've sort of had them continue over from the last council, awaiting what might happen and who we were going to be talking to here, but now that we know, I think we can have that conversation to figure out who's going to be liaisons to what. So I just wanted to give everyone kind of a heads up on that, that after the holidays, we'll revisit that and then set it for the balance of the 2017-2019 council. And that with that, that's the end of my report. We'll move on to the village attorney, I'm sorry, the village manager's report, item number nine. Almost cut you out there.
No report.
Well, apparently I was pressing it. Item 10, village attorney's report. Good evening, Ms. Petrucca.
Good evening, Mayor. Only several items to present tonight. The first is an ordinance designating the property at 3300 Finley Road as plan unit development number 57 to allow additional signage. An ordinance rezoning certain property located at 3300 Finley Road. An ordinance amending stormwater utility fees. And an ordinance amending mobile food vehicle vendor provisions. Will all appear on next week's active agenda. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, appreciate it. That brings us to item 11, Councilman Reports. Again, this is an opportunity for members of the council to either share items of interest or their goings on with the community, or to report out to the rest of the council something of pertinence in their role as liaisons, as they have been to this date. Speaking of liaisons, Commissioner Jose, good evening.
No report, Mayor, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Waldeck.
Thank you, Mayor. Thanks for the reminder on the Coffee with the Council. It's downtown, it's in the library, it's shopping time for Christmas. So Downers Grove, we are fortunate to have a variety of shops and things you can buy in the village, whether it's in the downtown area or elsewhere. So please do your shopping in Downers Grove and you know, help the village, help yourself by contributing to the sales tax. And we have a lot of unique items in town, so consider shopping local. Thanks.
Thank you. Well said, Commissioner. Commissioner Barnett, good evening.
I have no report, Mayor.
Thank you. Commissioner Earl?
No report.
Commissioner White?
No report.
And I have no further report. So with that, I will ask for a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good night. We are adjourned.